it is there. I think Tamils have been the leaders. Tamils have been the leaders in actually asserting Tamil nationalism or the actual nationalism. Indian nationalism is very new. The other nationalism has been there. It is ancient, it is older, but this Indian nationalism has overtaken all these identities. But it is the Tamil, under the leadership of Tamil nationals, that even other nationalities have been trying to assert themselves. So, it is, I will be doing a great injustice if I think that I am saying something new. But nevertheless, I want to share a few things that is happening in the present era and the changing nature of the question of nationalism. Presently, in fact, we are passing through an era, in the last 1 year, we have seen a big national movement in the age of globalization. Globalization actually offered us a new dream. It said that it is described by the utopians, saying that it is like a Vasudeva Kutumbakam. The whole world will become one. Some people said that the whole world will become a village. We will all become common citizenry of this world. But nevertheless, that has been a utopia, that has been just an illusion. Why? Because the forces behind globalization wanted to bring the whole world under their hegemony for their own. So that is why we have seen within a span of 2 decades of globalization, there has been a movement against that in the very heart of the capitalism. In the last 2 years, we saw the Brexit movement, where finally Britain came out of the European Union. Now we have seen BBC, Catalonia, which already friend Adalore have explained that whatever Tamil I could understand, with the help of the friends I could make it, is referring to that situation. So nationalism is one issue in this world, which is not just a feeling, it's a reality, it's a material existence. People live along with others with a voluntary spirit. This voluntary spirit not only extends to a nation, it extends to a family also. A family to survive with a democratic spirit, there should be a right to diverse. There should be equal right to continue that contract. A family is a contract. A nation is a contract. A Euro, a French philosopher says it's a daily plebiscite. Nation is a daily plebiscite. Every day we should express our political will to be part of a some particular federation. If there is no political will, if there is a kind of oppression, if there is an exploitation, if there is a hegemony, then it goes to actually remove. It will actually result in a kind of what they describe as a separatist movement, which I want to call it an assertion movement by the nationalities, by the nations. Largely, people want to just say that if there is a homogeneity of a particular nationality, that nationality will survive. For example, if a nationality has only one culture, or only one language, or common economic growth, then that nationality will survive, and any dissent within that is dubbed as some kind of foreign conspiracy. That has been the history of the world. For example, take something like, if there is one language, is language, one language is enough to constitute a nation. That has been proved completely false. In our history, in the present history, in a very contemporary history, we have seen Andhra Pradesh divided into two. You have Telangana, you have a Telangana state, and you have, together, you have Andhra state. Uttar Pradesh was divided into Uttar Pradesh, they were speaking Hindi. One language is not enough to actually retain a particular nationality as one. What is required is, there should be a condition of political will and mutual will. Whenever there is a material reality of exploitation, discrimination, this will definitely lead to a kind of rebellion. Say for example, if religion is enough to contain, to keep the whole country as one, that is also fine. We have seen Bangladesh as an example. It was East Pakistan, it became Bangladesh. Global forces actually manipulated, even India manipulated, but it is not just because of manipulation Bangladesh came into existence. It was a material reality, because the material reality was that religion was not just enough. East Pakistan was completely discriminated by the main Pakistan. Even if you say, if there is economic growth, there can be cultural discrimination, but if economic economic growth is sufficient to contain a nationality, to retain a nationalism. Even that is not enough. Catalonia is the biggest example. Within this Spain country, Catalonia is the one region which is most developed, but they are most discriminated. So even this discrimination leads to kind of prejudice. So we have the world history is filled with ample of examples that divide of only a nation can survive only when there is no discrimination, only when there is no hegemony, only when there is no exploitation. Exploitation, hegemony, and discrimination of any sort will lead to national liberation, and India is passing through such an era and globalization. In the name of, it gives a utopia, it sets a utopia day in and day out that we are all one, but a built-in capitalist agenda of crony capitalism. In fact, I am reminded of Raghuram Rajan's statement. You know Raghuram Rajan is a retired governor. He has given a full interview after recently when he came to India. He said, crony capitalism leads to popular nationalism. They are coming. When there is crony capitalism, it will only bankrupt popular national feeling. Like even today, this whole globalization is a global capitalist plan to actually subdue all real and genuine national feelings. I think we are passing through that era, and India has its own history, and I will come to it.
ஒவ்வொரு நாளும் தன்னுடைய அரசியல் அபிலாசத்தை மக்கள் மக்கள் வெளிப்பட்ட அரசியல் விருப்பங்களை மக்கள் வெளிப்படுத்துவதாக இருக்கிறார்கள். அந்த தேசியத்தை நசுக்கக்கூடிய ஆதிக்கம் ஒடுக்குமுறை என்பது ஒரு அவர்கள் சொல்வது அவர்கள் அவர்களுடைய தொழில் சொல்ல வேண்டும் என்றால் அதை ஒரு பிரிவினைவாத கோரிக்கைக்கு அதை எப்படி செல்கிறது. ஆனால் என்னை பொறுத்தவரை நான் அதை ஒரு தங்களுடைய தேசிய அடையாளத்தை உறுதிப்படுத்துவதாகத்தான் நான் அதை வரையறுப்பேன். ஒரு ஒற்றை தேசியம் இருப்பதற்கு பல்வேறு காரணிகள் சொல்லப்படுகின்றன. அந்த தேசியத்திற்குள் யாராவது ஒரு பொது அடையாளத்திற்கு வெளியே இருப்பவர்களை இருக்கும் மக்கள் குழுவை ஒரு அந்நிய சதி சதியினால் அவர்கள் இருக்கிறார்கள் என்பதாக விளக்கப்படுத்தப்படுகிறது. உண்மையில் ஒரு தேசியம் நீடித்திருப்பதற்கு மொழி ஒரு காரணியாக இருக்க வேண்டும் என்று சொல்லப்பட்டது. ஆனால் அது கூட உண்மை இல்லை. ஆந்திர பிரதேசம் ஒரே தெலுங்கு மொழியை பேசக்கூடியவர்கள் அவர்கள் இரு மாநிலமாக ஆந்திர பிரதேஷ் தெலங்கானா என்று பிரிந்தார்கள். உத்தரப்பிரதேசத்திலே ஒரே மொழியை பேசக்கூடிய இந்தி மொழி பேசக்கூடியவர்கள் இரு மாநிலமாக அவர்கள் பிரிந்தார்கள். எனவே ஒரு மொழி இருப்பது என்பது ஒரு தேசம் ஒரு தேசியம் நீடிப்பதற்கு அடிப்படை என்று நான் இதிலிருந்து அடிப்படை என்று சொல்லிவிட முடியாது. அது ஒரு அப்படி ஒரு அரசியல் விருப்பங்களை வெளிப்படுத்துவதற்கான ஒரு கூட்டு உணர்வோடு இருப்பதற்கான ஒரு பௌதீக யதார்த்தம் உறவாகத்தை இருக்க வேண்டும். அந்த தேசத்துக்குள்ளே வேறுபடுகள் இருக்கக்கூடாது, ஒடுக்குமுறைகள் இருக்கக்கூடாது. அதுதான் அந்த தேசியம் நீடிப்பதற்கான அடிப்படையாக இருக்கிறது. மேலும் மொழி அல்ல, ஒரு மதத்தின் அடிப்படையிலே ஒரு தேசம் தேசியம் நீடித்திருக்க முடியும் என்று சொன்னார்கள். அதுவும் உண்மை அல்ல. நாம் பாகிஸ்தான் பங்களாதேஷ் விவகாரத்திலே பார்த்திருக்கிறோம். அவருடைய பிரிவினையிலே சர்வதேச சக்திகள் அதை கையாண்டார்கள். இந்தியா அந்த பிரிவினையை கையாண்டது. ஆயினும் அவர்கள் பிரிவதற்கான ஒரு பௌதீக அடிப்படை இருந்தது. கிழக்கு பாகிஸ்தான் மேற்கு பாகிஸ்தான் என்று அவர்கள் இந்த மேற்கு கிழக்கு பாகிஸ்தானை மேற்கு பாகிஸ்தான் ஒடுக்குமுறை செலுத்தியது. எனவே அது பிரிந்து போகக்கூடிய ஒரு பொருளை யதார்த்தம் ஏற்பட்டது. ஒரு பொருளியல் வாழ்க்கை ஒரு பொருளாதார வளர்ச்சி என்பது தேசம் நீடிப்பதற்கு போதுமானது என்று சொல்லப்பட்டது. ஆனால் உலகமய சூழலிலே ஸ்பெயின் கேட்டலோனியா என்ற அங்கு நடந்து கொண்டிருக்கும் பிரச்சனையில் உண்மையில் கேட்டலோனியா மிகவும் வளர்ச்சியடைந்த ஒரு மாநிலமாகும். ஆனால் கேட்டலோனியா மக்கள் மிகவும் வேற்றுமைக்கு ஒரு பாகுபாடு காணப்பட்ட ஒரு மக்கள் பிரிவராக இருக்கிறார்கள். எனவே அவர்கள் பிரிந்து போக வேண்டிய கோரிக்கையை எழுப்ப வேண்டிய நிலை ஏற்பட்டது. எனவே பொருளாதார வளர்ச்சி கூட ஒரு தேசியத்தை நீடித்து வைப்பதற்கு போதுமானது என்று நாம் முடிவு செய்து வர முடியாது. மனிதர்களுடைய வரலாற்றிலே மனுஷங்க வரலாற்றிலே இது போன்ற எண்ணற்ற உதாரணங்களை நாம் எடுத்துச் சொல்ல முடியும். போன்ற குறியீட்டு விஷயங்கள் மொழி மதம் பொருளாதார வளர்ச்சி இவை ஒரு தேசியம் நீடிப்பதற்கு போதுமானது என்று நாம் முடிவு செய்து வர முடியாது. எங்கே ஒடுக்குமுறை இருக்கிறதோ, எங்கே ஆதிக்கம் இருக்கிறதோ, எங்கே சுரண்டல் இருக்கிறதோ, அங்கே இந்த ஒரு தேசம் நீடிப்பதற்கான ஒரு அடித்தளத்தை அது நிலந்திருக்கிறது. இந்தியாவின் முக்கியமான சகாப்தத்தை கடந்து கொண்டிருக்கிறது. ஒரு உலகமய காலகட்டத்திலே மீண்டும் மீண்டும் ஒரு கற்பனை நமக்கு ஒரு விற்கப்படுகிறது. அந்த கற்பனையும் ஒரு மாயை விற்கப்படுகிறது. உலகமயத்திலே எல்லா பொருட்களையும் ஒரு கிராமமாக வந்திருக்கிறோம் என்று அண்மையில் இந்த ஆர்பிஐயிலிருந்து வெளியேறிய ஆர்பிஐயுடைய கவர்னர் ரகுராம் கூட சொன்னார். அந்த சூறையாடல் முதலாளித்துவம் கிரானிக் ஆக்டிசம் இந்த உலகமயத்தில் உருவெடுத்துள்ள சூறையாடல் முதலாளித்துவம் என்பது ஒரு மிகவும் ஒரு பரந்தப்பட்ட ஒரு பாப்புலரான ஒரு தேசிய வாதத்திற்கு இட்டு செல்லும் என்று அவர் நேரடியாக சொல்லியிருக்கிறார். குரோனிக் ஆக்டிசம் லீட்ஸ் டு பாப்புலர் நேஷனலிசம் என்று. எனவே இந்த உலக முதலாளித்துவம் குளோபல் கேப் உலக முதலாளித்துவம் என்பது அனைத்து தேசியங்களையும் ஒடுக்கக்கூடியதாக இருக்கிறது. எனவே இந்தியாவுடைய வரலாறு என்பது மிகவும் தனித்துவமானது. அதை இப்படி நான் விளக்குகிறேன்.
I completely agree with the speakers who spoke before me that India was never a nation, India was a subcontinent. India was a country, country is a given thing, subcontinent is a given thing. You have emperors, in fact even for that matter, except Ashoka who crossed India thousands of years before, no other emperor in this country have ruled what we call India today. Hardly the rulers of North crossed India, hardly the rulers of the South crossed went over the India. Hardly, there are few exceptions. But there are emperors, and emperors will have only subjects. Emperors will have only people. But when you say nation, nation will be made of people, not people, but citizens. Citizens are empowered voters. Are the empowered citizenry only make a kind of democratic consensus to be
there in the formation of nation. So Indian nation, the idea of Indian nation only emerged in our fight against colonial units. We were different federated units. There were many provinces, still we were not even nations. But definitely there were nationalities. That's why when we say Tamil is a very old nationality which aspired to become national, Kannada is a separate nationality. Indian nationality never was there prior to British colonialism. But other nationalities were there, were very much thriving. They had their own language, culture, and aspirations, and a political will to become an independent nation. That's why Mr. Annadurai was referring to Ambedkar. I will come to that later. I will just finish. So, a nation needs a political will, as I said before. Along with geographical contiguity, along with economic sustenance, you need a political will because it presumes that there is a conscious and empowered citizen who will vote for it, who will give their consent to that through plebiscite. Indian freedom struggle, as I said, as against anti-colonialism, was emerging, which a political will was emerging to become an Indian nation. I am not looking out there. India was fighting a common enemy, different federating units, different people of different provinces, in spite of belonging to different nationalities, they were fighting against a common enemy, and through that, an idea of India evolved, an idea of Indian nationhood evolved. It was up to the leaders, the constitution makers, the political leaders, the economic elite, it was up to them to sustain that idea, to make it a material reality. That would have been become a clear possibility when only that political will was given a democratic agency. What I mean by that, if there is equality of different nationalities, equality among the people, no discrimination, if these things were assured, India would have become a definitely a sustainable nation. But right from the beginning there were problems, and in fact, the Indian freedom movement, Indian leaders, and the Indian constitution neglected or did not heed to the caution given by Periyar and Ambedkar, and that's why we are in this situation. I think the caution given by Periyar is completely explained, and you know it better, I will not repeat that. But when I come to Ambedkar, I have 3 points to say. Ambedkar said 3 things very clearly. When he said very clearly that if Hindu nation becomes a reality, Hindu nation or Hindutva is antithetical to democracy. It is an opposite to democracy, and without a democracy, a nation cannot survive. A modern nation cannot survive. So Hindu nation is an enemy of a democratic India. That is what he said. He said very clear. Second thing, he spoke in a very clear sense, it is a very celebrated article about Pakistan, about the question of Pakistan. He says, he actually argues in that whole essay that there is nationalism, there is nationality. Every nationality will be dormant, but a nationalism comes as a political aspiration, and a nationhood, by becoming a nation state, will become a reality when only that nationhood takes an agency. So a nationality should have a practical existence. There was no Hindu nationality, there was no Pakistan nationality till 1936 in Indian subcontinent. That was cultivated by the Congress dormant bias to Hindu religion, which Ambedkar vividly explains. Especially the Hindu nationalist forces like Savarkar. He actually had a big article about Savarkar where he explains. In the whole history of this world, you have 2 kinds of federating units. If you have 2 completely opposite kinds of nationality, they cannot survive together unless there is a complete autonomy, unless there is a complete democracy. He gives few examples. Belgium is one example, he says. But then Norway and Sweden, how it was, they were together and finally how they were separated. He gives another example. But when 2 opposite construed kind of nationality, if they live together and if there is a domination, world has always seen complete extermination of other nationality. But the world has never seen a kind of a nation where a dominant nation will perpetually suppress a dominant nation. Because without any political right, even for the right for voting. So that kind of nation cannot exist. Instead of that becoming a reality, I vote for Pakistan. They should be two different nations, because this kind of perpetual domination cannot survive for long. This is one caution you gave. The third very, very important caution, which generally the Ambedkar, the leftists also generally forget, is that in his beautiful essay called Federation and Freedom, where he argues, he was not for federation for once. Why? Why? Because who were actually asking for more power? They were actually princely states. And who were these princely states? They were feudal powers. So if feudal powers get more power, he just asked the question of what would happen to the oppressed within that feudal independent federated unit. So instead of that, it is better that we are in a union. For us who are actually living in this age of globalization, or in this age of after 70 years of Indian federation, it may look odd. But if you see, if you go to those days and understand what happened, who have agreed to become the part of Indian Union? The first prince who agreed to become the part of Indian Union was Mysore Maharaja. What was the urge? What was the thrust? There was a big anti-king movement. There was a big movement for a real democracy within the Mysore state. As against that, he wanted complete kind of political shift from the so-called Indian Union. Then take for example Manipur. Manipur, there was a big rebellion of farmers against the kings. There was one great peasant leader. He was not a communist, but he had inclination towards Marxism, called Hirawa. It is called Hirawa rebellion. Manipur was actually up in the farmers were rebelling against their king for real democracy. Then the Manipur king actually colludes with Sardar Patel and becomes part of India. Take for example Nagas. Gandhi gave complete assurance to Fizzo, who was then Nagas leader. He said that we will not force you. Nobody can be taken to even heaven through force, because if you take anybody by force to heaven, that becomes a hell to you. He should volunteer. He should volunteer. Then even the Nehru said, nothing doing, you should be part of India.